In the Victorian era, England's northern towns and cities experienced nothing short of an architectural transformation. In a golden age of civic architecture, the North created buildings that expressed the fashions and the philosophies of the day. But behind the grand facades, there are human stories, personal conflicts, private passions, lives and loves set in stone. These civic buildings were bankrolled by proceeds from the Industrial Revolution, which turned modest market towns into vast modern cities. The manufacturing towns of northern England were the frontier to the world's industrialized cities, but there was no roadmap for any of this. It would take characters of exceptional conviction to step forward and harness the opportunities of the modern age. It was they who rebuilt the north of England for a new industrialized way of life. Their ideas were brave and visionary, and for better or for worse, we're still living with their legacy. When northerners first grew rich from the fruits of industry, they furnished their towns with neoclassical buildings to educate and enlighten. But as the 19th century wore on, they tired of this formal elegance. By the height of the Victorian age, a very different aesthetic, Gothic, would capture hearts and minds. Its freedom and versatility would redefine urban landscapes right across the north. This is the Temple of Liberty at Stowe House in Buckinghamshire, built from 1741 for the parliamentarian Richard Temple. It's perhaps a surprising place to start a story about northern civic architecture. But it was in garden follies like this that Gothic, a style born in the 12th century, was relaunched, first playfully by 18th century aristocrats, then seriously by social reformers, and then ubiquitously by Victorian architects as their civic style of choice. Gothic style is both hard and easy to define. It's hard because even in the Middle Ages, Gothic style kept evolving. A 12th century Gothic building doesn't look much like a 15th century one, for example. And they change from place to place, so florid Spanish Gothic is different to French tall Gothic to broad English Gothic. The Temple of Liberty is Gothic by virtue of having a pointed arch. That's the central motif of Gothic style. The rest is just variations on its theme. When Gothic was rediscovered in the 18th century, its very flexibility, the fact that a Gothic arch had no fixed proportion but could be as broad or as tall as you wanted, gave creative designers a sense of new potential. It gave patrons the idea that they could reflect themselves and their own image, not in Mediterranean classical history, but in the nation's own history. Whilst the Temple of Liberty looks playful, it carried serious overtones of ancient British political freedoms. But into the Victorian era, Gothic became the vehicle for a new awakening of social conscience. The style would then be eagerly adopted by the urban, industrial north. At the beginning of the 19th century, Manchester was a market town, but within 50 years, it would become the world's first industrialized city. Cotton made modern Manchester. It became the bustling hub of Lancashire's lucrative cotton trade.
But there was a social price to pay for this progress. Manchester's population increased sixfold in 60 years. Its residents faced deafening mills, smog-ridden streets, and a life expectancy of just 26 years. As one visitor put it, from this filthy sewer, pure gold flows.
The Victorians came to believe you could judge the health of a society by its built environment. When many saw the grimy conditions of the industrial north with factories and slums, they had real cause for concern. How could they fail to conclude that their society was in serious decline? More to the point, what could they do about it?
What became known as the condition of England question gave politicians and social reformers alike many a sleepless night.
Industrial cities had never existed before, so no one knew how to deal with their problems. The issue of cynical, insanitary, jerry-built slums met with a raft of bylaws, for this was not yet an age of mass social housing. Instead, it would be civic architecture which would affect the moral tone. And in seeking a new, brighter future, the Victorians looked to the past. Medieval ecclesiastical architecture travelled through the ages to provide a blueprint for Victorian town planners and architects.
One evangelical young man would start an architectural revolution that would change the face of towns and cities across the north. Augustus Welby Northmore Pugin was a colourful character. By the time he was 21, he'd already been shipwrecked, bankrupt, and widowed twice.
He had this rather peculiar education. He learned about architecture travelling with his father and his father's drawing pupils. And he learned about architecture by measuring it, climbing over it, digging round it. Pugin and his father, for example, trying to work out how a vault was held up, just bored a hole through the top and lowered actually some of the smaller drawing school pupils inside and told them to draw what they could see.
A boy-sized hole in a vault.
Yeah, a boy-sized hole in a vault. And they found it quite difficult to get them out afterwards. Pugin went around filling these sketchbooks and very typically, not only just picking on the details, but he's got belfry windows very good. He was singling out the things he liked.
He's a real magpie brain for detail, isn't he?
Yes.
And careful with it.
Yes. Gradually, he begins to assemble all this, you see. And so he's restoring the churches in his imagination as they were before the Reformation, before the statues were smashed, before the stained glass was spoiled. And so gradually, you can see his view of the Middle Ages changing from a view of history to a manifesto for the present and for the future, something he's going to rebuild and recreate.
And so the uses of the past, this wasn't necessarily seen as a retrogressive thing. He was actually very forward-looking in the way that the ingredients from the past created a new recipe for the future.
Well, he and his whole generation, I think probably the 1840s was the last time until the 1960s that the whole of Europe was driven by the youngest rising generation. And they were revivalists, but in the most positive kind of sense, that they wanted to reanimate the present using the past. They simply wanted to revive what felt like rather a tired, stale, anxious society. And they saw in the Middle Ages the material to do it.
In his most influential work, Contrasts, Pugin compared an imaginary medieval town with the same place in the 19th century. These sketches show how Pugin idealized medieval society. The prominent spires symbolize the harmonious and godly community, whilst in the soulless Victorian city, industry and commerce reign, and factories dominate the skyline.
Powerful pictures. How was it received?
It was received very enthusiastically. Suddenly they realised that all the questions that were being put about the city, about the condition of England, and this boring architecture they were doing, you could put these two things together. Architecture could be a social force. No one had thought like that before. So it was immensely influential.
Pugin popularised the medieval past as an architectural template and social manifesto for the future. The message was particularly pertinent in the urban, industrial north. Like Manchester, Leeds had been transformed by the Industrial Revolution. By the 1830s, it boasted over 100 woolen mills, employing nearly 10,000 people. St. Peter's, the town's Protestant church, was run down, and the size of its congregation was pitiful. Enter a dedicated churchman, Walter Farquhar Hook. Hook shared Pugin's belief in the improving influence of architecture. On becoming vicar of St. Peter's, he had the church remodeled in elevating Gothic style. Rebuild was funded by the local council, but in true public spirit, Hook took a cut in his salary and moved to a smaller parsonage, making a personal contribution too. The revamped St. Peter's was the biggest church to be built in Britain since St. Paul's Cathedral. But would it be enough to revitalise Leeds' ailing Anglican community?
St. Peter's Leeds is a million miles from a plain Georgian preaching box. It's a radical building, but nonetheless, it's one which managed to find a compromise between high and low church. Chantrell, the architect, had listened to Pugin. You can see how the structure, this stonework, which is learned from York Minster itself, a product of the English Catholic Middle Ages, has ornament which is integrally related to the structure. It's a serious and scholarly exercise. That big west window with the stained glass is obviously looking back seriously at medieval precedent. But you look at the pews, 700 of these were given over to parishioners, so it democratized church attendance. You didn't have to pay a rent to sit here. You did upstairs. It's a different matter, up a special staircase. But these pews are largely confections in the Puginian way that ornament should be related to the structure. This is ornament for ornament's sake, and it's not scholarly anymore. You wouldn't find these galleries in a medieval church, and the ornament is made with papier-mâché. It's all sort of added on and less than serious. You get the sense that Chantrell might hope one day they'd simply be taken away. And then there is the East End. You have both a pulpit where the low church word is being preached, and then the East End elevated on a platform where the Catholic rites might be reenacted. It appeals to both sides. By achieving this compromise, it's an incredibly important building for the development of Victorian church architecture.
Hook's impact on Leeds was remarkable. His charismatic sermons attracted standing room only crowds. As one congregation member recorded, September 1856, went to parish church, but could not get in, was full. But Hook's influence went beyond the walls of St. Peter's. He fought for the education of children across the parish and backed the construction of 30 schools. Hook and the church he built were a shining example of how Pugin's principles could revitalize a community. The vogue for medievalism, combined with concern about the architectural health of the nation, would see Gothic move beyond ecclesiastical architecture to become a suitable style for the North's great civic structures too. It was a chance event which occurred one sunny evening in 1834 that eased Gothic's passage from the sacred to the secular.